Good morning, everyone. It's Pastor Jim Harkabas once again from the Canyon Community Church in Lincoln, California. It's February the 12th, 2023. This morning, we continue our walk through the New Testament book of 1 Corinthians, which will be the theme of that book is Correcting Spiritual Immaturity in the Local Church. We're looking at chapter 12 and looking at the spiritual gifts, the effect gifts of wisdom, of knowledge, of faith, and of miracles. Glad you're with us. Let's have a song, and we'll join our message in progress.
Splendor of a king, clothed in majesty, let all the earth rejoice, all the earth rejoice. He wraps himself in light, and darkness tries to hide. Trembles at his voice, trembles at his voice. How great is our God? Sing with me, how great is our God? And all will see how great is our God.
This morning we'll be picking up our study, going to the New Testament book of 1 Corinthians. If you want to open your Bibles with me there. The theme of this book is correcting spiritual immaturity in the local church. And we've seen so far in this letter, the Apostle Paul has been addressing various problems and issues affecting this young church. But at the core of the issue that they're wrestling with, whether it's sexual immorality or whether it is strife and divisions within the church, at the core of the issue of their problem was carnality, spiritual immaturity, which was resulting in worldly thinking and behavior. And we saw 1 Corinthians chapter 3, and I'll look there in your Bibles with me, 1 Corinthians 3, 1 to 3, I'll look there briefly, as Paul diagnoses the root problem that's going on there. 1 Corinthians 3, verses 1 through 3. And he says, "And I, brethren, could not speak to you as to spiritual men, but as to men of flesh, as to infants in Christ. I gave you milk to drink, not solid food, for you're not able to receive it. And even now, you're not able, for you're still fleshly. For since there is jealousy and strife among you, are you not fleshly or not walking like mere men?" In other words, are you not walking like those who are not saved? And so Paul's been dealing with this church and a host of other issues, but that was the core issue. And it was manifesting in these side issues, haven't addressed it, but that was the crux of it. We discovered in chapter 11 that this carnality, this spiritual infancy or immaturity, was being carried over into church life and even in the public worship. And Paul pointed out the need for structure and order in regards to church life, ranging from local customs to dress to even conduct, how you conduct yourself at church socials, to even as they celebrate the Lord's table, celebrate communion. And the key verse in chapters 11 through 14 is going to be this. 1 Corinthians 14:40 says, "But all things must be done properly and in an orderly manner." So that's what he's trying to set straight here, some of their public issues that they were dealing with in public worship and their public, you know, social life as a church. And in chapters 12 through 14, Paul's addressing yet another area that the Corinthian church was struggling in, that carnality in spiritual immaturity was resulting in chaos and was abuse of the spiritual gifts, in particular the speaking gifts of prophecy and of glossa, or if you want to call it tongues. I hate that particular translation of that word, of languages. Paul's topic of spiritual gifts details in these chapters 12, 13, and 14, details the intent and the use of spiritual gifts within the church assembly. And they are to be regulated by both love, we'll cover that in chapter 13, and he's going to put strict limitations or bumper rails, if you would, on chapter 14 on some of those gifts of prophecy and of speaking in languages. Bumper rail, I think of when you go bowling and they have those little rubber bumper rails so you don't get gutter balls. It keeps you within where you're supposed to be. Kind of like I-5 with the guardrails, because it keeps you where you're supposed to be on the roadway if you sleep. And so he's going to put strict limitations on the use of those gifts, bumper rails, if you would, so they will be, all things be done orderly in a proper manner. And to summarize what we've learned so far in our study of the spiritual gifts, we've learned that every Christian has been given a spiritual gift by the Holy Spirit to be used to strengthen and mature the body of Christ, the church. We saw that in Timothy, also saw in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 10. We've learned that each of the gifts mentioned in Scripture are sovereignly distributed by the Holy Spirit as He wills. In 1 Corinthians 12, verse 11, we'll see that this morning as we read that passage. It's not something we want to go shopping for. The Holy Spirit is the one that gives the gifts. Three, we learned that these special gifts are to be under the control of God's Spirit by the believer living a Spirit-led or Spirit-controlled life, and to be used to help mature the body of Christ. It's not, the gifts are not intended for our own personal entertainment or for our own personal, quote-unquote, edification. And four, we learned that a word study of 1 Corinthians 12, we're looking at again, we'll be looking at just reading in just a moment, indicates there are three distinct groupings, if you would, of spiritual gifts. 1 Corinthians 12:4. Let's look there for a moment. 1 Corinthians 12, that's going to be our passage this morning. He said, "No, there are varieties or diversity of gifts, but the same Spirit. 1 Corinthians 12:5 says there are a variety of ministries and the same Lord. And verse 6 says there are a variety of effects, but the same God who works all things in all persons. So a diversity or grouping of gifts. Secondly, a grouping or diversity of ministries, diaconia, we could one who serves or roles or functions. And a third grouping is that of effects or manifestations. Energemia is the Greek word, it means a list or effects or results. And we've looked at the first grouping already, the motivation gifts. They're listed in Romans chapter 12. We looked at prophecy, we looked at serving, we looked at teaching, we looked at exhorting, we looked at giving, we looked at leadership, and we looked at mercy, 7. We've looked at the ministry role gifts, the second grouping mentioned in Ephesians chapter 4, of an apostle or a missionary, if you would, of a prophet, evangelist, a pastor, and teacher. Which leads us for that third grouping, a third of gifts, the effect gifts. And there's 9 mentioned here in 1 Corinthians chapter 12. I'm reading 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 1 to 11. We'll just pick it up. It's been a while since we've been in 1 Corinthians, so let's read through the passage together. I'm reading 1 Corinthians chapter 12, beginning at verse 1. And I will comment as I go along, because we've already covered this. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not want you to be unaware. And if you recall that Paul says, I don't want you to be unaware of what's going on with the spiritual gifts. And remember the King James, a little more blunt about it. I would not have you be ignorant. I would not have you be an ignoramus. And most of the problems people have with the spiritual gifts in the church is they don't know the scriptures. They don't know what the scripture says about the spiritual gifts. Verse 2, you know you were led, pagans, you were led astray to the mute idols, however you were led. And we've learned also that in the pagan religions, whether it's the New Age movement, a lot of chants, a lot of weird stuff going on. And a lot of drug-induced chanting and stuff going on. That what they do. So you did that when you were before you were a Christian. But now, you're different. Verse 3. Therefore I make known to you that no one speaking by the Spirit of God says Jesus is accursed, and no one can say Jesus is Lord except by the Holy Spirit. Verse 4, we've seen this. Now there are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are a variety of ministries or roles, but the same Lord. There are a variety of effects, but the same God who works all things in all persons. But to each one is given the manifestation of the gift for, catch it, for the common good. Verse 8, for one is given a word of wisdom through the Spirit. And to another, the word of knowledge through the same Spirit. To another, faith by the same Spirit. And other gifts of healing by the one Spirit. And to another, the effectiveness of miracles to one another. And to another, the effectiveness of miracles, verse 10. And to another, prophecy. And another, distinguishing of spirits. To another, various kinds of glossa. I refuse to use the word tongues. This caused so much confusion. Another word for glossa is language. When we get the word glossary, definition of terms. And to another, the interpretation of glossa or of languages. But the one and same Spirit works all these things, distributing to each one individually as He wills. May God bless this word this morning. We'll be looking at the effect gifts. We'll look at 5 of them this morning. The first one, to one is given the word of wisdom through the Spirit. Verse 8, the New Living Translation puts it, to one the Spirit gives the ability to give wise advice. And as I mentioned, we're going to cover 5 of the effect gifts, a word of wisdom, a word of knowledge, faith, healing, and effecting of miracles. The word of wisdom. Wisdom is mentioned 216 times in the Bible. That's a lot. And to briefly lay a foundation on wisdom, we need to understand there are 2 types of wisdom. There's, first off, the wisdom of this world, or the wisdom of this age, and is demonically inspired and promoted by society today. And then there's God's wisdom, a wisdom from above, based on his revelation, the Bible. And the two are incompatible. They do not mix. Look at some scriptures. James 3:13. Let's look to James for a moment. We'll look at a couple of scriptures on wisdom. Who among you is wise and understanding? Let him show by his good behavior his deeds in the gentleness of wisdom. But if you have bitter jealousy and selfish ambition in your heart, do not be arrogant and so lie against the truth. This wisdom is not that which comes from above, but it's earthly, natural, demonic. For where jealousy and selfish ambition exist, there is disorder in every evil thing. And folks, pause. That's what's going on. That was happening in Corinth. Selfish ambition, strife, jealousy. They were living by the world's wisdom that they gleaned from their Greek culture, and they're bringing it into the church, and it was causing devastation. And that's what same thing going on in churches today. They bring the world's wisdom in, what they learn from a fortune cookie, or they learn on TV programs rather than from the Word of God. But the wisdom from above, we're reading James 3:17. But the wisdom from above is first pure, and then peace-loving, gentle, reasonable, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial, free of hypocrisy. Another scripture reference found going back to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. It says, yet we do speak wisdom among those who are mature. A wisdom, however, not of this age, nor of the rulers of this world who are passing away. But we speak God's wisdom in a mystery, the hidden wisdom which God predestined before the ages to our glory, the wisdom which none of the rulers of this age has understood. For if they had understood it, they would not have crucified the Lord of glory. And folks, this wisdom that we're talking about, this wisdom from above, this wisdom of God, is found only in one place and one place only, in His Word, the Bible. Psalm 111, verse 10. Let's look to Psalm 111 for a moment. Keep a finger in 1 Corinthians. We're coming back to it. But Psalm 111, verse 10 says this. It says, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. All who follow His commandments have a good understanding, and His praise endures forever. Where is this? You see the connection? Wisdom, God's commandments. Proverbs chapter 2, verse 6. Then we'll head back to 1 Corinthians. Proverbs 2, verse 6. After the Psalms, Proverbs has so much to say about wisdom. As part of the wisdom literature, so is such as song, along with Psalms. Proverbs 2:6 says, for the Lord gives wisdom, and from His mouth comes knowledge and understanding. So wisdom is not found, as I mentioned, in the Chinese fortune cookie. Those are so lame. You're going to make a friend this week, or you're going to get a better job. It's so generic. It's not found in the TV shows. No, it's not found on the news things. It's not found in the public education system, and definitely not found in the Ivy League universities of our day. Their thinks are so wise. Such knowledge and wisdom is useless, and is always wrong. It's carnal. It's worldly. A word of wisdom will always be scripture-based. Let me repeat that. A word of wisdom from God will always, always, always be scripture-based. And it will be given to you by the Holy Spirit through the scriptures. A couple of Bible examples. I'm going to take the time to look there. If you're taking notes, Genesis 41. The story of Joseph reading or interpreting Pharaoh's dreams. Pharaoh, if Egypt had a dream by God, God spoke to Pharaoh in a dream, and Joseph interpreted, but he's interpreting God's revelation to Pharaoh. See, God gave the revelation and knowledge to Pharaoh, and Joseph is applying the knowledge to life. Here's what's going to happen to me. 7 plentiful years, 7 years of famine, and here's what you need to do. A word of wisdom. Daniel, in the book of Daniel, interpreted dreams of that God gave to Nebuchadnezzar and helped Belshazzar to understand the handwriting on the wall. Remember that story? In Daniel chapter 2, chapter 4, and chapter 5. See, a word of wisdom is always scripture-based. It's always scripture-encountered, and application is drawn from that. As I mentioned, the book of Proverbs is always filled with words of knowledge and wisdom to be applied to life. As you read through the Proverbs, one will stick out to you, and the Holy Spirit will say, you know, you might want to remember that, Joe or Jim or Jane. A word of wisdom came to me recently in my Israel trip. The tour guide was sharing a story, a scripture story of 1 Chronicles 13. How David, when he was in the process of moving the ark up to Jerusalem, he went, made plans. There was a big parade. They were doing this, but he didn't do it right. As a result of that, a man died. His name is Uzzah. He touched the ark and he died. David messed up. And he had to go back and review what he did wrong, and did he did it right the second time with the Levites carrying the ark, doing to put the ark on a, it was just, you know, doing what the word was done. He just threw the ark on a cart and was not God approved. He was not doing it God's way, and that's so his judgment came from that. And I realized that, you know, I needed to do some review in my own life and how I do ministry, and God used that. The guide was sharing the scripture story, and Holy Spirit said, Jim, there's some application for you. There's a word of wisdom. And so I'm trying to apply that to my life. A word of wisdom. Another word of knowledge, according to the same Spirit, in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 8. The New Living Translation says, to another, the same Spirit gives a message of special knowledge. A word of knowledge is a factual knowledge based on God's word and truth. And a word of knowledge came to me on the Israel trip. A lot of words of knowledge and wisdom came on the trip. But I was exposed to the Word of God for hours on a day, lesson after lesson after lesson. You see, it's always Scripture-based. And if you want God to speak to you, He's going to speak to you through the Scriptures. Not from TV, not from a book, but from the Scriptures. Immerse yourself in the Scriptures, beloved. Learning about the Jordan River Valley and the multitudes of people, that thousands of people that followed Jesus, but also for following and right around John the Baptizer. And really because of the Jordan River Valley from Galilee down to the Dead Sea, it was a flat valley, plenty of water, very produce, easy to travel versus traveling over the mountains. Would you rather travel over Sugarloaf Mountain or go over the interstate up the Dog Creek? If you went to interstate, it would be a lot faster than trying to go over hill, over day, over to Dog Creek, over Sugarloaf Mountain. And so it is. It was a word of knowledge about the terrain and the history and the culture and why he did that. It made the Scriptures come alive. Both words of wisdom and words of knowledge come from whom? From God, as he's speaking through his word, the Bible. A third gift, effect gift, a result, is to another faith by the same Spirit. Verse 9. New Living Translation says the same Spirit gives great faith to another. This gift of faith is distinct and different from saving faith. This faith, or pistis is the Greek word, is a special extra dose of the ability to trust God. And it's seen in persistent, unwavering prayer and waiting upon Him. And God gives a gift of faith. Amazing story, two stories from the Bible, was a woman with a chronic flow of blood for 12 years. I'm reading from Matthew's account in Matthew chapter 9. And Matthew's at 9, 20, verse 20, will say, I'll give you a chance to turn there. Matthew 9:20 says, and behold, a woman who had been suffering from a hemorrhage for 12 years came up behind him, meaning Jesus, and she touched the border of his cloak, for she was saying to herself, if I only touch his cloak, I will get well. And Jesus, turning and seeing her, said, daughter, take courage, your faith has made her well. For at once the woman was made well. And more details in Luke chapter 8. If you're watching the Chosen series, episode 5 of season 3, fantastic story. This woman just pressing through the crowd. She said, if I only just touch him. God gave her the faith. Her faith made her well. She just touched a garment and she was healed. A measure of faith. Another measure of faith is found in the same story in Luke chapter 8. In Luke's account with Jairus's, He was asked Jesus to come heal his daughter who was very sick and dying. And I'm reading Luke chapter 8, verse 49. While he was still speaking, someone came from the house of the synagogue official saying, "Your daughter has died, and do not trouble the teacher anymore." But Jesus, when he heard this, he responded to him. He responded to Jairus, says, "Do not be afraid any longer. Only believe, and she will be made well." And God grants an extra measure of faith at times of great challenges and of difficulty. Think of George Mueller and his orphanage home provision. Think of husband Taylor starting the Inland China Mission. I think of the Canyon Community Church. Some of you were around for this, some of you were not, but in 1996, the church property was originally on Forest Service leased land. And the church was trying to get out from under this property, but we couldn't just sell it, buy it from the Forest Service. Forest Service wouldn't sell it to us, but they said, if you buy this 80 acres of property up in the middle of nowhere in Hearst Mountain where there's nothing but rattlesnakes and manzanita and probably some marijuana overlooking Hearst Bay, we'll buy that, we'll trade with you, we'll do a property swap. They couldn't sell it outright because it's in the National Recreation Area. Well, after 20 years of struggling, it was time. But the church needed $45,000. We prayed, said, "God, this is the view you're going to provide." And the Lord provided. $45,000 came in, enough to seal the deal, and we bought this land full of mountain gates or rattlesnakes and poison oak and manzanita bushes. And Forest Service was happy to get their manzanita bushes and their rattlesnakes, and we got the church property in the church's name. A gift of faith. And God gives gifts of faith in times of great challenges and difficulty. Debbie shared how her dying brother, who's now deceased, came to Christ. And she prayed, and we prayed for him. She had faith. Do you have an unsaved loved one, beloved? Or maybe a backslidden loved one? Don't give up. Ask God to work in their lives. Ask him for faith, knowing that he will accomplish what you ask. James 4:2 says, "You don't have because you do not ask." That's true. And sometimes you ask and don't receive because you've asked for the wrong motives. You're asking, "Lord, I want a new gizmo. I want a new whatever." You don't receive because you ask for the wrong motives that you may spend in your requests on your own pleasures. But 1 John 5:14 says, "This is the confidence we have before him, that if we ask anything according to his will, he hears us. And if we know that he hears us, whatever we ask, we know we have a request we've asked of him." Pray in faith and see what God will do. The fourth effect gift we find is that of healing. I'm reading 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9, "And to another, gifts of healing by the one Spirit. Gifts can be, this healing can be physical, it can be emotional, it can be spiritual. And I think the greater one, a spiritual healing, when a person comes, the greatest miracle, the greatest healing of all, when a person surrenders their life to Jesus Christ and are born again, become a part of the family of God. Because that's an eternal healing, not a temporary physical healing. But we see gifts of healing occur on a fairly regular basis. We just see it. Sometimes God heals supernaturally. Sometimes he uses medical science to do it. I think of my adventure, if you would, with Guillain-Barré syndrome in 2018, medical science God used, and God's timing and all those details. Here I am standing before you today. Definitely the gift of healing occurs. Verse 10, "And to another, the effecting of miracles." As the fifth gift, a result gift, note that the miracle is affected not by an individual's power, but through God working through an individual. Very much to notice, because sometimes people lose track of that. See, supernatural occurrences, when we think of miracles, it could be a provision, it could be a protection, occur on a regular basis. Things happen that we cannot explain logically. It's not luck, it's not coincidence. It's God's supernatural working in our lives. Well, does God work miracles today? And the answer is absolutely yes. The question is, because we've watched television, for what it's worth, does God designate certain individuals to whom he works miracles through? And God sometimes works miracles through people according to his will and divine purposes. But I want to give a disclaimer. In regard to so-called miracle workers or the Word of Faith movement, a televangelist, if you would, if you see on TV, who claim to have the power to do miracles upon demand, who do miracles upon demand, I will call bovine scat. Bovine is a cow. Scat is poo-poo. I'll call BS. Call it what it is. And we've all seen these televangelists on display, strutting around and crowing like on stage, like in front of the camera, like roosters in a barnyard. Just make a lot of noise and drawing attention to themselves. Filled with pride, filled with self-righteousness, oh, how spiritual I am. And they're strutting about. And my friend, that's not of God. I'm sorry. And I'll share why in just a minute. And sadly, ignorance and misunderstanding of these verses has caused great harm to people. That's what bothers me the most, into the gospel of Jesus Christ. I've been observed people in the Reading grocery store, some well-meaning people, Christians, who think they can heal upon demand. They'll approach a person in a scooter or wheelchair and offer to heal them. Well, who wouldn't want to be healed if you're in a wheelchair? Wouldn't you want to be healed? Of course you would. But when it doesn't occur, then they blame the victim for the victim's lack of faith to be healed. Well, what's wrong there? It's not the victim. It wasn't their lack of faith. It's they misunderstood the scriptures. The issue is not the lack of faith. The issue is ignorance, misunderstanding of the spiritual gifts and the scriptures. And it causes great harm to people. They're devastated. I could be healed, but I don't heal. It's me. What's my problem? And then so they become bitter. I've seen people, these same people show up at accident, fatal accident scenes in hospital ERs seeking to raise the dead. Contrary to the Word of Faith movement and their theology and their claims, God is not running a health and wealth club. God's not running a health and wealth club. Life is not about you being healthy, and God's not, and life is not about you being wealthy and having everything you want plus more to spend on yourselves. God is calling people to be a part of his coming kingdom. And what we see in this world today is not it. There's a coming kingdom. And as far as death is concerned, 1 Corinthians 15:50 says this. And we'll see that we get to the 15th chapter of 1 Corinthians. He says, "Now I say, brethren, that flesh and blood cannot inherit the kingdom of God, nor does the imperishable inherit, excuse me, nor does the perishable inherit the imperishable." Folks, someday we're all going to die if the Lord should tarry. You just got to nail that down. You're not exempt. Someday you'll be having a memorial service. Well, they'll have it for you. You won't be here. And it's worth noting that even with the health and wealth movement, you know, their lifespan is about the same as everyone else's. They don't live to be 200 years old, 300 years old, 500 years old. They live and they die like the rest. So there's something deficient with the health and wealth movement, the Word of Faith movement, theology, a lack of understanding of the scriptures. In fact, if they talk to them, they don't know the scriptures. They're running off of something else, emotions, experience, quote unquote, but not the scriptures, what God has to say. When God does effect miracles, and he does so for his greater purposes, of which we may not understand on this side of eternity. As far as the effect of miracles through individuals, H.A. Ironside tells the story of an African tribe who cried out to their various deities, their tribal gods, to help relieve a horrible drought to no effect. And a Bible missionary prayed for rain. He called the people and said, "I'm going to pray for rain." And as he was finishing up, praying, a cloud began to form while he prayed, and soon heavy rain and lightning occurred with the drought ending, having ended. That was a miracle. And many tribal people were amazed that this God who could do miracles, while their deities could not, and they believed the gospel message so as to be saved. God can and does work miracles through individuals who trust Him and pray. But it's not about the individual, but about the God who does the miracle. And we need to understand that God will not share His glory with another. Isaiah 42:8 says this. He says, I am the Lord, that is my name. I will not give my glory to anyone else, nor will I share my praise with carved idols. And if God uses you to lead someone to Jesus Christ, or God uses you to bless somebody, it's not about you. And it's not about me. It's about Him. It's about Him. It's important that we keep that focus. What about so-called miracle workers claims today? It's a valid question, because we see through that. You just turn on your TV and just craziness. I want to close with Matthew chapter 7. Matthew chapter 7. A very sobering passage. We've covered it before, but it's something we need to understand. Matthew chapter 7, beginning verse 15. Says, beware. Jesus is speaking. Sermon on the Mount. He says, chapter 7, verse 15, beware of the false prophets who come to you in sheep's clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will know them by their fruits. Grapes are not gathered from thorn bushes, nor figs from thistles, are they? So every good tree bears good fruit, but the bad tree bears bad fruit. A good tree cannot produce bad fruit, nor can a bad tree produce good fruit. Every tree that does not bear good fruit is cut down and thrown into the fire. So then, you will know them by their fruits. Verse 21, Matthew 7, verse 21. Not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, will enter the kingdom of heaven. But he who does the will of my Father who is in heaven will enter. Many will say to me on that day, and just pause, he's talking about the coming day of judgment. Lord, Lord, did we not prophesy in your name? And in your name cast out demons? And in your name perform many miracles? Verse 23. And then I would declare to them, I never knew you. Depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. For that's one of the most sobering passages of Scripture from the words of our Lord Jesus Christ Himself. Some observations on this passage. Number one, false prophets and false miracle workers will be present in the end times. They're present in the time of Christ. They're present today. In fact, as the end time draws nearer to its conclusion, and the return of Jesus Christ, they become more prolific, in fact, be more than fleas on a coyote. Two, you can recognize false prophets and false miracle workers by their fruits. They're easy to recognize if you're looking, if you're paying attention to what Jesus had to say in the Scriptures. And realize that the greatest false miracle worker is yet to come, and many will be saved by him. I'm reading from 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 8, talking about the day of the Lord that's going to come, talking about the Antichrist. 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 8 says, and then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord will eliminate with the breath of his mouth and put an end by the appearance of his coming, talking about the second coming of Christ in glory. That is, the one who is in accord with the activity of Satan, with all power and false signs and wonders, and with all the deception of wickedness for those who perish because, catch this, they did not accept the love of the truth so as to be saved. For this reason, God will send upon them a deluding influence that they'll believe what is false, in order that they may all be judged who did not believe the truth, but took pleasure in wickedness. And it gets down to it. As I mentioned, God speaks, and the Holy Spirit speaks through words of knowledge and of wisdom through what? This and this alone. The question is, will you and I listen to the truth of the scriptures, the source of all knowledge and wisdom we've looked at this morning? Or will we choose to believe, rely upon our own personal experience? Will we put our own personal experience or our history over the authority of Scripture? The question is, are you wiser? You know more than what God is saying in His Word? But a person may say, well, I had an experience. I'll tell the story of a man I encountered years ago on the Murfreesboro field in Kansas. He was telling me his story. He encountered Jesus Christ personally. I said, this ought to be interesting. Jesus appeared to him. He was on his bed, and Jesus appeared over him, talking to him over in his bedroom. You can't say he didn't have an experience, but what does the Bible say about those who encountered personally Jesus Christ? Well, I think the Apostle John, we encountered the risen Christ in the book of the Revelation. What was John's response? He was, hi, Jesus. No, that's not. He was passed out from his glory, the risen Christ. When I think of the book of Isaiah, when Isaiah encountered the risen Lord in the temple on his throne, what was the Isaiah's response? Of great unworthiness. He says, woe, they is me. He recognized his own sin in the presence of the holiness of God. It wasn't, hi. That's not what happened. I think of the book of Daniel, and Daniel encountered the risen Christ, the pre-incarnate Christ in Daniel chapter 10. And he saw him, and Daniel did what? Oh, wow, that's cool. No. Flat out on the ground, passed out. And those who didn't see it, they just knew something really bad was happening, and they all ran away. Those who claim to encounter Jesus Christ, biblically, the biblical response is passed out from God's presence and glory. That is the only proper biblical response. Unless we're saying we're better than John, we're better than Daniel, we're better than Isaiah. See, our experience must be subordinate to the Scriptures. Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. We believe that in the book of Hebrews chapter 13. Then our experiences must be subordinate to the Scriptures. As to the man who Jesus was floating above his bed, and you can change the scenario. He had an experience, all right, but he had just had two or three bongs of Mendocino gold, cannabis. It was drug-induced. I said, well, I can explain why he probably had that happen. Lay off the cannabis. Remember, beloved, our experiences must be subject to the Word of God. And God speaks through the Scriptures. And all our experiences must be subject in subjection to the Word of God. Going forward, we covered 5 of the 9 effect gifts mentioned in 1 Corinthians 12. Next week, we'll finish a checklist of the effect gifts, and then we will begin to learn how the gifts are the function within the body of Christ. We begin in chapter 12, last part of chapter 12, chapter 13, and chapter 14. We'll learn about the bumper rails God has put in place. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this time and your word. We thank you for these gifts you've given to us. Lord, you've given these gifts to us to bless us and to edify the body of Christ as a whole. May we study to show ourselves approved unto you. May we dig deep into the Scriptures to understand what the Scriptures are saying, to understand the grammar, understand the words, understand the background, the history behind what was taking place, that we may, Holy Spirit might give us application. Thank you, Lord, for your word. May it go forth this morning. We give you praise, and we thank you for Jesus Christ, who died and rose again, and gives eternal life to all who will believe in him. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Let us stand, we'll close with a song.
The perfect wisdom of our God. revealed in all the universe. All things created by his hand and held together at his command. He knows the mysteries of the seas. The secrets of the stars are his. He guides the planets on their way and turns the earth through another day. The matchless wisdom of his ways that mark the path of righteousness. His word a lamp unto my feet, his spirit teaching and guiding me. And oh, the mystery of the cross, that God should suffer for the lost, so that the fool might shame the wise, and all the glory might go to Christ. Teach me humbly to receive the sun and rain of your sovereignty. Each strand of sorrow has a place within this tapestry of grace. So through the trials I choose to see your perfect will in your perfect way. Each strand of sorrow has a place within this tapestry of grace. So through the trials I choose to see your perfect will in your perfect way.